Within the last couple of years, America's racist history has become a huge topic within the marketplace of ideas. As a result, more and more people are starting to reevaluate a lot of the cultural elements that have been adopted by default, one of those elements being the race and ethnicity of Jesus. For a very long time, people believed that Jesus was a white man. Recently, people are starting to believe that Jesus was a black man. Due to his Hebrew roots and a passage that we find in Revelations that says that Jesus' skin was like bronze that was removed from a furnace and his hair was white like wool, a lot of people are starting to think differently about the ethnic and racial makeup of Jesus. Now, is it true? Is it true that Jesus was black because of his Hebrew roots? Does Jesus' Hebrew roots even identify anything about an African or black heritage? And does the Bible actually teach in the book of Revelations that Jesus' hair texture was tough like the texture of most African American or black people? And does the Bible teach that Jesus' skin tone was actually dark? To begin, let's look at a book that many people use to identify what Jesus' racial makeup was. Revelation chapter 1 verses 14 and 15 says, "His head and hair were white like wool, white as snow, and his eyes like a fiery flame. His feet were like fine bronze as it is fired in the furnace, and his voice like the sound of cascading waters." For us to better understand this passage, we have to understand the literary genre of the book of Revelations. The book of Revelations is a particular kind of Jewish literature called apocalyptic literature. Apocalyptic literature features all of what it discusses in allegorical ways. Allegories are a particular kind of literature that represents people and places in symbolic ways using people, places, or mythological creatures that do not exist. A great example of this would be the tortoise and the hare. The story of the tortoise and the hare introduces two characters that are not real: a turtle who is slow and a rabbit who is fast, both of which speak. Animals do not speak in the English language. Now, what is the purpose of this story? The purpose of the story is to symbolize how hardworking people who move slow and are consistent often outdo people like the rabbit, who are fast learners and talented but are arrogant and lazy. Because of the way the story uses two mythological creatures to symbolize real people in real situations, the book or the story of the tortoise and the hare becomes what we know as an allegory. That is what is happening in 90% of the book of Revelations. In the book of Revelations, a great example of this is seen in chapter 12, verse 3, where we are introduced to a character called the dragon. The dragon in Revelations 12:3 is using his tail to sweep one third of the stars out of heaven. Now, many of us are taught that the devil convinced one third of the angels to join him in his rebellion against God. We get that story, that idea, from Revelation chapter 12, verse 3. The dragon is an allegory to symbolize Satan, and the stars are an allegory to symbolize the angels. The usage of allegory in this way is what we see taking place in the first chapter of Revelations in verses 14 and 15. In those two verses, we are not being told what Jesus' literal characteristics were like. Instead, we are being told what his divine nature was like by way of symbolic representations, making it an allegory. Now, let's say for a second that the book of Revelations was meant to be taken literally in all situations that are introduced within that book. If we were to take verses 14 and 15 literally, we would have to conclude a number of things that don't totally make sense. First, verses 14 and 15 are not describing Jesus as a man with tough hair. The texture of Jesus' hair is not the topic in the discussion in those two verses. Instead, it is the color of his hair. It says that Jesus' hair was white like wool, not tough like wool. And it also goes on to say that his hair was white as snow, which is a good indication that the passage is talking about the color, not the texture. Also, we do not know any human being, let alone a black person, who was born with 100% white hair. Also, the color of bronze is brown or tan. It is not black. ebony is what we know as black, but bronze does not represent the color black in any way. So even if we were to take these verses literally, which we shouldn't because the literary genre does not go in that direction, we would still land at an ethnic makeup of Jesus that was not African or black. Now, based off of the text that we use, we start to see that Jesus was not necessarily a black person. However, that doesn't necessarily prove what Jesus's racial and ethnic makeup was. We know he wasn't black, but does that mean that Jesus was white? For us to better understand that, let's do a deep dive into the genealogy of Jesus. Jesus, when we trace as far back as we are able to, descended from a man named Shem. Shem is first introduced in the book of Genesis chapter 5 as one of Noah's three kids. It was Shem, Ham, and Japheth. In Genesis chapter 11, we start to see Shem's genealogy up until a man named Abraham. Abraham is where Jesus eventually comes from, and Abraham was first known as Abram before his name was changed. Now, in Genesis chapter 11, when we get to Abram, it's said that him and his wife were leaving their home, which was the Ur of the Chaldeans. The Ur of the Chaldeans is not a term that we use today. The term we use today to describe that location called the Ur of the Chaldeans is southern Iraq. What do people from southern Iraq look like? They look like this. Now, this doesn't fully describe what Jesus looked like ethnically and racially yet. So let's go a little further. Abraham had two kids, Ishmael and Isaac. Isaac is the child where Jesus's line descends from. Isaac was a product of Abraham and his half-sister Sarah's relationship, which means that there was no mixing that produced this man, Isaac. Isaac then marries his first cousin, Rebecca, and they have two kids, Jacob and Esau, and Jacob's line is the line that eventually leads to Jesus. Jacob marries four women, two of them are his first cousins, and the other two are the servants of those two cousins that he marries, meaning all of them came from the same place, making all of them the same ethnic background. So there is no mixing that takes place within the first three patriarchs of the line that eventually leads to Jesus. And Jacob, who is later named Israel, has 12 kids with the four women that he gets married to. And after he has those 12 kids, those 12 have kids as well. So it's about 50 people in total that eventually go into the nation of Egypt as a result of a number of events that take place in the book of Genesis. Those 50 people that enter Egypt eventually leave Egypt 400 years later in the story of the book of Exodus, and those 50 people turn into over 600,000 people. Most likely for 50 people to turn into 600,000 people within 400 years, there was mixing that took place. The mixing most likely was with the Egyptians, and we have a good idea that this is most likely what happened because Joshua, one of the 12 kids of Israel, making him one of the tribes of Israel, married Pharaoh's daughter and had a couple of kids with her, making those kids half Israelite, half Egyptian. According to The Verge, the ancient Egyptians look like modern day Syrians. So what do modern day Syrians look like? They look like this. These are the kinds of people that the Israelites, who look like the people from Iraq, would have mixed with, meaning that all of the people leading down to Jesus eventually would have been brown. But to be even more precise, we see that two other places conquered Israel, which would have meant that there might have been some mixing that took place within those cultures as well. What are those two places? Those two places are Babylon and Assyria. Babylon and Assyria are both located in what we now call Iraq, which furthers the idea that all of the mixing outside of the tribe of Israel was with people who were primarily brown in skin tone, not white and not black. Jesus was a Hebrew. Hebrews are Semites. Semites are any people whose origins trace back to what is considered Southwest Asia, which another term for Southwest Asia is the ancient Near East, Near East, or the Middle East, which would mean that Jesus is not white either. Jesus would have looked like a person from the Middle East. Jesus would have been brown skin, not dark skin. And to be even more precise, one of the key factors of a person being from Africa is that their skin is dark and their hair is tough. Whereas people that are from the Middle East, while they have brown skin, which the skin can sometimes be pretty dark, their hair texture isn't the same as the hair texture of a person from Africa. So what this information should caution us from is the identity politics that are happening within the Christian faith. White people who are Christians tend to want Jesus to be white, so that way Jesus represents their white values. And black Christians want Jesus to be black so that Jesus represents their values, which in both cases we know is wrong because Jesus was neither from Europe or Africa. Jesus was from the Middle East, and he didn't have black values or African values or white values or a white background. He had Asian Middle Eastern values and a cultural background in that regard. Thank you again for watching. Let me know what you guys think in the comments below. Why do you guys think it's important for Jesus to either be black or white? And let me know, why is it that you have not heard that Jesus was actually Middle Eastern if this information is new to you? God bless.